السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الحمد لله ولي الصالحين، والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين، نبينا وإمامنا وحبيبنا وسيدنا وقرة عيننا محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحابته أجمعين. أما بعد، فنعم الله تبارك وتعالى علينا كثيرة تترى، ومن هذه النعم أن جمعنا في هذا المكان المبارك في بيت من بيوت الله تبارك وتعالى على اختلاف ألسنتنا وجنسياتنا. فأسأل الله تبارك وتعالى أن يجعل اجتماعنا هذا اجتماعا مرحوما، وأن يجعل تفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما، ولا يجعل معنا ولا فينا شقيا ولا محرومة. وأسأله جل وعلا أن يجمعنا مرة ثانية في مستقر رحمته في جنات عدن عند ملك مقتدر.
أبو الشيخ عثمان الخميس حفظه الله began by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sending his salutations upon our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then he said, indeed the blessings of Allah azza wa jal are many and numerous upon us. And from amongst those blessings is that Allah Azza wa Jal has gathered us in this place, in one of His houses, so that we can come together, even though we come from different countries and we speak different languages. And so he made dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes this sitting and gathering of us a gathering of mercy, and that after we leave, inshallah, we leave with our sins expiated, and that every single person here is included within that dua. And he also made another dua that Allah Azza wa Jal allows us to gather once again in the shade of His mercy subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment in His paradise.
ابتداءً أشكر القائمين على هذا المسجد المبارك على إقامة مثل هذه الندوات والمؤتمرات النافعة، وأسأل الله تبارك وتعالى يتمم لهم مرادهم في نشر الحق ورد الباطل. ولا شك أن الموضوع كبير جدا ولا يمكن تغطيته بمثل هذا الوقت القصير، فأنا الآن عندي أقل من ساعة، ومع الترجمة يعني أقل من نصف ساعة، ثم يقال لي أسهب. هذا لا يمكن أبدا، ولكني أشكرهم على بذل السبب، وكما قيل ما لا يدرك جله لا يترك كله، فيكون هناك يعني إشارات وومضات عن هذا الموضوع الذي أسأل الله تبارك وتعالى أن ييسر أمره.
The Sheikh said that I wanted to begin by thanking the people that are responsible for this masjid and for this conference for participating and organizing such a seminar. And he asks Allah Azza wa Jal that he allows us to reach our goal of spreading the truth and making clear what is false and evil. He said that this is a vast subject and a vast topic, and it's something which in such a short space of time it is impossible to give it its due right. The Sheikh said that I have less than an hour to complete this lecture by itself, and then we have the translation, so that makes it even shorter. It's very difficult to go through this topic in a lot of detail and to be comprehensive about it. But as they say, or as it is said in the Arabic language, just because you can't do something in a complete sense doesn't mean that you don't do anything at all. So the Sheikh said that we will give a number of pointers and mention as many points as we can, inshallah, in order to clarify the subject to the best of our ability.
إن الصراع بين الحق والباطل قديم، منذ أن خلق الله آدم صلوات ربي وسلامه عليه وأعلن العداء له إبليس أعاذنا الله وإياكم من شره، بدأ الصراع بين الحق والباطل، وأخبر ربنا تبارك وتعالى أن هذا الصراع مستمر إلى أن تقوم الساعة. وإذا قال إبليس فبعزتك لأغوينهم أجمعين إلا عبادك منهم المخلصين، وسأل الله تبارك وتعالى أن ينظره إلى يوم الدين، ف فقال الله له إنك من المنظرين. فالصراع إذن مستمر.
The Sheikh said that the battle between truth and falsehood is a battle which is very old, and it began from the day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created our father Adam alayhi salatu wassalam. And from the moment that Iblis, may Allah Azza wa Jal protect us from his evil, from the moment that he refused to prostrate to the Prophet Adam. So it is an old, old battle. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran that this would continue until the day of judgment. And that's why Iblis, as is reported in the Quran, he said to Allah that through your might and your power, I will misguide all of them except for your sincere slaves. And as is also mentioned in the Quran, he sought the permission of Allah to be able to live until the day of judgment so that he can continue to misguide people, and Allah Azza wa Jal granted him his request.
وقد أخبر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بالخبر الصحيح الذي أخرجه الترمذي وأحمد وغيرهما أن اليهود افترقوا إلى 71 فرقة وأن النصارى افترقوا إلى 72 فرقة وأن هذه الأمة ستفترق إلى 73 فرقة. فهذا أمر خبر من النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أن ستكون هناك فرق وستكون هناك اختلافات. ثم بيّن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أين يكون الحق عندما سئل فأين الحق يا رسول الله، قال أو عن طائفة المنصور لما ذكرها قال هم الذين على ما أنا عليه اليوم وأصحابي.
The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned in an authentic hadith as is collected by Imam al-Tirmidhi and Imam Ahmad and other than them that the Jews will split and they will differentiate into 71 different sects, and that the Christians will also split into 72 different sects, and that this ummah, the Muslim ummah, will split into 73 different sects. So this is a testament, and this is something which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam informed us of, that there would be sects and that there would be differences. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made clear the path that is true and correct. When he was asked about that and about what is the correct way, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is that which I and my companions are upon today.
فلا تحزنوا لوجود هذه الفرق، ولكن اهتموا بكيفية معرفتها والتعامل معها وأين تكون الفرقة الناجية حتى ننتمي إليها وننتسب لها، لأن هذا أمر قدري، قدر الله، أخبر الله أن هذا الأمر سيكون، فلا ننازع الله في قدره، ولكننا يجب علينا أن نتعامل مع الواقع كما هو.
The Sheikh said, so therefore, now that we know that there's going to be so much differing and so many sects, do not become grieved, do not become sad as a result of this. But rather what you should do is to place importance upon knowing about these different sects and how to deal with them, and knowing about what is the correct and the victorious group and sect from amongst them, so that you can be from amongst them insha'Allah. This is something which Allah Azza wa Jal has decreed, that there will be differences and that there will be sects. So there is no point trying to oppose the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rather, we know how to work with the decree of Allah by learning about these sects and by safeguarding ourselves as well.
وذكرنا أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أخبر أن المنتسبين إلى الإسلام سينقسمون إلى 73 فرقة. هذا العدد بعض أهل العلم يرى أنه ليس مقصودا لذاته، وإنما يريد أن الفرق كثيرة، وعلى كل رؤوس الفرق ستة، ست فرق هي الفرق الكبرى، تسمى الفرق الكبرى. أولهم أهل السنة والجماعة، أهل الحديث، هذه الفرقة الأولى أهل السنة. الفرقة الثانية الشيعة. الثالثة الخوارج. الرابعة القدرية. الخامسة المرجئة. والسادسة الجهمية. والفرق الخمس المخالفة لأهل السنة تشعبت إلى فرق كما سيأتي ذكره.
The Shaykh said that our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam therefore informed us that the people who ascribed themselves to this religion, the Muslims, were split into 73 different sects. And the Shaykh said some of the scholars of Islam were of the opinion that 73, the number 73, was not what was meant in and of itself, meaning that the number is not important. What the meaning is that there will be many, many different sects. Either way, the Shaykh said that all of these sects can be categorized into six. These are the main six categories of sects, and from them you have many offshoots that come as a result of them. These six main categories are number one, Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah or Ahlul Hadith, number two, the Shia, number three, the Khawarij, number four, the Qadariyah, number five, the Murji'ah, and number six, the Jahmiyah. And from these six main categories, you have all of these various sects coming off as a result of them.
وموضوع هذا المؤتمر إحدى هذه الفرق المنحرفة وهم الشيعة. هذه الفرقة وحدها انقسمت إلى أكثر من 70 فرقة. وأشهرها يعني الفرق الكبرى فيها الزيدية والاثنى عشرية والإسماعيلية والنصيرية والدروز والبهائية والبابية والقرامطة. وهناك فرق أخرى كثيرة كما قلت هي قريب من 70 فرقة.
The Shaykh says the topic and the theme of today's seminar is to discuss one of those six main categories or one of those categories of sects, and that is the category of the Shia. The Shaykh said that this category in and of itself split into 70 different offshoots. So there are 70 different sects that come just from the Shia in and of itself. The Shaykh said that from amongst the most famous of them is the Zaydiya, the Ithna Ashariya, the Ismailiyya, the Nusayriya, the Duruz, the Al-Baha'iyya, Al-Babiyya, and Al-Qaramita. These are just some of the names of the most famous of the sects of the Shia, but as he said, there are almost 70 of them.
أما كيف نشأت هذه الفرقة فمرت بمراحل. نشأة هذه الفرقة مرت بمراحل. المرحلة الأولى كانت فردية على يد رجل يهودي من أهل صنعاء اليمن اسمه عبد الله بن سبأ. هذا الرجل تبنى قولا عظيما ألا وهو القول بألوهية علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه.
The Shaykh said as for the history and the formation and how it developed this sect of the Shia, he said that it went through a number of stages. The first stage was beginning with a single person. One person that began this concept of what would later become the Shia, and that was a man who was a Jew by the name of Abdullah ibn Saba, and he was from Sana'a, the modern day capital of Yemen. And he was the one who first came up with the concept and with the statement that Ali radiallahu anh was in reality a god.
Abdullah ibn Saba ادعى الإسلام وأظهره، ثم بعد ذلك ادعى أن عليا هو الله والعياذ بالله، وادعى أن عليا هو الوصي بعد النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وادعى أن أصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خذلوا عليا وغدروا به وأخذوا حقه، وكان ذلك أي خروج هذا الرجل ودعوته كان ذلك في آخر خلافة عثمان بن عفان.
So this man Abdullah ibn Saba, he claimed to be a Muslim and he made apparent that he was a Muslim, and he was the one who first said that Ali was Allah, that Ali is a God, he is Allah, and he was also the first person to say that Ali radiallahu anhu should have been the leader after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he was also the one to say that the other companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, may Allah be pleased with them, that they were deceitful and they cheated Ali out of this right of being the successor of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And this man, he appeared towards the end of the Khilafah and the time of Uthman radiyallahu anhu.
وفي خلافة علي رضي الله عنه جاءه أناس فقالوا له أنت هو، فقال ومن هو؟ قالوا أنت الله. فاستنكر علي ذلك القول ثم قال أغيركم يقول ذلك؟ قالوا هم كثير. قال أحضروهم. فلما حضروا عنده في الكوفة رضي الله عنه حذرهم من هذا القول وقال إنما أنا عبد من عبيد الله، إن أطعت أثابني إن شاء، وإن عصيت عذبني إن شاء، وإنما أنا بشر آكل الطعام وأشرب الشراب، فارجعوا عن قولكم. فأبوا ذلك، فأمهلهم 3 أيام في كل يوم ينكر عليهم هذا القول رضي الله عنه. فلما كان اليوم 3 أمر بحفر حفر في الأرض وأشعلت فيها النيران ثم أحرق من لم يرجع.
The Shaykh said, so this was towards the end of the Khilaf of Uthman. When he came to the Khilaf of Ali radiallahu an, a group of people came to him in Kufa where he was, and they said to him that you are he, you are he. And so he said, who is he? And they replied that you are Allah. So he became angry at this and he rebuked them severely. And he asked them, do other people claim this other than you? They said, yes, there are a great multitude of people who say this. So he told them to go and bring all of those people. So they came in Kufa where he was resident and he began to warn them of saying this. And he said to them, rather I am a servant from the many servants of Allah. If I obey Allah, then Allah will reward me if he pleases. And if I disobey Allah, Allah will punish me if he pleases. Instead, I am a human. I eat and I drink. So go back from this statement of yours, meaning retract what you're saying. So they refused to do so. So he gave them 3 days. Every single day he would come and he would warn them again. But on the 3rd day, when he realized that they wouldn't retract their statement, he ordered that a number of pits be dug in the earth, and he lit fire within those pits and he threw those people within the fire.
عندها انقسموا إلى 3 أقسام. قسم رجع وقالوا كنا نظن أنك الله، فإذا أنكرت ذلك فنحن نرجع عن هذا القول. وقسم رمى نفسه في النار وقال لا يعذب في النار إلا إله، إذن أنت الله. وقسم أظهر الرجوع وكتم الكفر ولم يظهره. واستمر الأمر على ذلك في كتمان هذه العقيدة الباطلة.
The Shaykh said, so when he began to dig these pits and he lit fire within them and he threatened to throw them in the fire, those people, they divided into 3 groups. The first group was those people who retracted. And they said to him that if you say that you're not a god, then we take your word for it, you're not a god. And they retracted that statement. The second group, they threw themselves willingly into the fire. And they said that only the god of fire can punish with the fire. So therefore, this is proof that you are a god. And the third group, they said that they retracted, but in reality, within their hearts, they still had this belief. So openly, they retracted, but inwardly, they still had this belief. And this latter group, the third group, they continued to conceal their true beliefs for some time.
في تلك الفترة، هذه المجموعة سواء التي رجعت أو التي قتلت أو التي كتمت، في تلك الفترة لم يكن لهم مساجد خاصة بهم، مساجد للشيعة، ولم يكن لهم فقه خاص بهم، ولم يكن لهم علماء يتبعونهم، ولكن كانوا يعيشون مع أهل السنة بدون إظهار أي خلاف لذلك.
And he said that during this time, these groups, whether they were the groups that would later retract, or whether they were the ones who were thrown in the fire, or whether the ones who only openly retracted but inwardly still had this belief, all of these people, during that time, they didn't have their own masajid, they didn't have their own mosques, they didn't have their own scholars, they didn't have their own type of fiqh or their own type of methodology, but rather they lived with the other Muslims and they were resident with them.
فتستطيع أن تقول إلى تلك الفترة، نحن نتكلم عن سنة 40 من الهجرة، إلى تلك الفترة لم يكن هناك شيء اسمه شيعة، وإنما لما حصل القتال بين علي ومعاوية رضي الله عنهما في معركة صفين كان يقال شيعة علي وشيعة معاوية، فلم يكن هناك فرقة عند الناس تسمى فرقة الشيعة.
So the Shaykh said, so during this time and up until this time, and we're talking approximately about the year 40 Hijrah, there was no such thing known as the Shia. The Shia were not known in this way and by this term. And this continued until even when the dispute that took place between Ali radiallahu anhu and Muawiyah radiallahu anhu and the battle that ensued in As-Siffin, the people would say that these are the supporters of Ali, the Shia of Ali, and the supporters of Muawiyah, the Shia of Muawiyah.
واستمر الأمر على ذلك حتى كانت سنة 60 من الهجرة إلى سنة 60 من الهجرة لا يوجد شيء اسمه شيعة كفرقة أو كدين أو مذهب أو مساجد أو فقه أو كذا، لا يوجد شيء من هذا. في سنة 60 من الهجرة عندما توفي معاوية وجعل الخلافة لولده يزيد، عندها امتنع الحسين بن علي وعبد الله بن الزبير من المبايعة ليزيد، وعلم أهل العراق أهل الكوفة أن الحسين لم يبايع، فأرسلوا إليه الكتب يقولون له تعالى نحن نبايعك ونحن لا نريد يزيد.
And this continued, the state of affairs continued until the 60th year of the Hijrah, the year 60. So they had no mosques, there was no such group known as the Shia, they had no scholars and so on and so forth. In the year 60 of the Hijrah, that is when Muawiyah radiallahu anhu passed away. And after his death, he chose as his successor and he appointed as his successor his own son Yazid. And it was there at this time when he appointed Yazid and after the death of Muawiyah that Hussein, the grandson of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu anhuma, both of these companions refused to give the pledge of allegiance to Yazid. And so when the people of Kufa, when the people of Iraq, they heard that Hussein refused to give the pledge of allegiance to Yazid, they wrote to him a great number of letters asking him to come to Iraq so that they could give him the pledge of allegiance instead.
وإلى هذه المدة وهي سنة 60 لم يكن هناك للشيعة مساجد خاصة وعلماء ومذهب وفرقة أبدا، ولكن يعيشون مع أهل السنة، كل ما في الأمر أن هناك مجموعة تحب عليا وترى أنه هو الخليفة، أو الحسين وترى أنه هو الخليفة، ولا تريد خلافة بني أمية.
So at this point, again, just to reiterate, the 60th year of the Hijrah, they have no masjids, they have no scholars, there is no such thing known as the Shia, but rather they live with everyone else. The people of Ahlul Sunnah, they live with them and they are resident with them, they abide with them, they deal with them. The only difference is that these people believe that Ali and Hussein and that family, they have more right to the Khilafah than the people of Banu Umayyah.
وقصة الحسين رضي الله عنه لما ذهب إلى الكوفة طويلة جدا، وسأعتصرها وأختصرها بجملتين. الجملة الأولى أن الحسين رضي الله عنه بعد أن جاءته الدعوة من العراق أو من الكوفة بالذات قصدهم ليستلم الخلافة من بدل يزيد، ولكن الذين دعوه غدروا به وخرجوا إليه وقتلوه رضي الله عنه، وقد اعترف بذلك علماء الشيعة ومنهم العاملي محسن الأمين ومنهم المطهري ومنهم الإحسائي وغيرهم كثير، اعترفوا وقالوا إن الشيعة الذين دعوا الحسين إليهم خرجوا إليه وقتلوه رضي الله عنه وأرضاه.
The Shaykh said that as for the story of Hussein and his travel to Kufa and what took place, he said that's a very long story and time doesn't allow for us to go into all of that detail. He said that I will summarize it within two statements. The first is that after Hussein radiallahu anhu, after he received these letters inviting him to Kufa, he went with the intention of taking the pledge of allegiance from them and becoming the Khalifa. However, those people who invited him, once he arrived in Kufa or near Kufa, they were deceitful, they cheated and they deceived him and they ended up killing him instead. And this is something which the scholars of the Shia themselves, they acknowledge and they mention, such as Al-Amili and Al-Mutahiri and Al-Ihsai, and many of their scholars, they all agree to this, that the Shia, those people who invited Hussein, would later be treacherous towards him and they would end up killing him.
وهذا ليس غريبا عليهم إذ غدروا قبله بعلي بن أبي طالب وبالحسن بن علي وبمسلم بن عقيل، فهذه الصفة لازمة لهم.
And the Shaykh said that this isn't something strange for them to be treacherous in this way. It's not something strange for them. But because before this, before Hussein, they were treacherous towards Ali and towards Al-Hasan and towards Muslim ibn Aqil.
النقطة الثانية التي اختصروا بها مقتل حسين رضي الله عنه أنه حصل عند كثير من أهل الكوفة نوع من الندم أنهم كيف دعوا الحسين ثم خذلوه، وخرج منهم من خرج لقتله رضي الله عنه، وهناك من لم يخرج لقتله لكنه خذله ولم ينصره، فشعروا بشيء من الذنب، وذلك في سنة 61 عندما قتل، واستمر هذا الندم وهذه الحسرة إلى سنة 64 بعد موت يزيد، فكونوا جيشا وسموه جيش التوابين ليكفروا عن خطيئتهم في عدم نصرة الحسين أو في الغدر به رضي الله عنه.
So the Shaykh said that when this took place, and this is like the second portion of the summarized version of the death of Hussein, the second point was that when this took place and when this treachery took place and he was killed, he was martyred رضي الله عنه, many of the people of Kufa, they were remorseful, they had regret that how was it possible that this great companion comes to us and then not only do we not support him but we're treacherous towards him and we kill him. So either there were a group of people from those people who went out to him, either they killed him or at the very least they didn't support him and defend him. And so they became extremely remorseful. And this was in the year 61 Hijri. And this continued for a number of years until the year 64, that they had this remorse and this regret until the death of Yazid. And after the death of Yazid, they then formed an army so that they could expiate for the sin that they performed, that they committed in not defending Hussein. They formed this army and they called it the army of Tawabin, which means those people who are repentful.
من هنا سنة 64 عندما نظموا هذا الجيش للانتقام من قتل الحسين رضي الله عنه، هذا هو التحول الثاني للشيعة، وهنا التحول السياسي، بدأت تنظيما سياسيا الآن، لكن إلى هذه المرحلة إلى الآن هم يصلون مع أهل السنة، لا يقولون بتحريف القرآن، لا يسبون الصحابة، لا يطوفون حول القبور، لا يدعون غير الله تبارك وتعالى، لا يقولون بالعصمة، لا يقولون بالأئمة الاثني عشر، لا يقولون بشيء من ذلك، وإنما هي فرقة أو جماعة سياسية تريد أن يكون الحكم لآل بيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
So in this year, the year 64, when they formed this army, the army of the repentful, he said now this begins the second stage in their development, and that is when they take a political stance. They delve into politics. Up until this time, they're still praying and living with the people of Ahlul Sunnah. They don't curse the companions. They don't have these 12 imams. They don't claim that they are infallible. They don't call other than Allah. They do everything else that is the same. They only have this issue. But now begins the politics, when they move into politics, and that is that they believe that the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam should be the leaders of the ummah.
Na'udu إلى كلامنا الأول لما تكلمنا عن الفرق المنحرفة التي أخبر عنها النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وهي خمس فرق، قلنا الشيعة والخوارج والمرجئة والمعتزلة والجهمية. فرقتان من هذه الفرق بدايتها كانت سياسية وليست عقدية، ليست دينية، وهما الشيعة والخوارج. وأما الجهمية والمعتزلة والمرجئة فهؤلاء فرق عقدية من ابتدائها ولم تقاتل أصلا لهذه العقائد، وأما الشيعة والخوارج فهي في الأصل فرقتان سياسيتان ثم تحولتا إلى فرقتين دينيتين.
The Shaykh said, let us just go back to what we said concerning the way that we categorize these sects. And we said that other than Ahlul Sunnah, there are five other categories, the Shia and the Khawarij and the Qadariya and the Murji'ah and the Jahmiyyah. The Shaykh said that all of these five categories From them, two of these groups, the beginnings were because of the politics. They delved into politics, and that was their beginning. It wasn't about religion, wasn't about creed, wasn't about methodology, wasn't about aqidah. It was about politics. And those two groups are the Khawarij and the Shia. He said, as for the other three, then they began from the beginning, they began with issues of creed. Their differences were issues of creed. As for the Khawarij and the Shia, their issues at the beginning were politics. But then they later evolved into creed and aspects of aqidah.
بعد سنة 64 خمدت نارهم ولم يظهر لهم شيء واستمر هذا الأمر فترة طويلة جدا حتى جاء القرن الثالث الهجري بل الرابع الهجري عندما ظهر بعض الناس الذين حاولوا أن يحرفوا هؤلاء عن عقيدة أهل السنة والجماعة فهم منحرفون سياسيا في الأصل لكن أرادوا أن يحرفوهم عقديا فخرج جماعة من العلماء من علماء ينتسبون إلى هذا الفكر أو هذا التوجه السياسي منهم النعماني والكليني والصدوق والمفيد وغيرهم فحرفوا هؤلاء إذ جعلوا لهم لأنهم كانوا منحرفين سياسيا الآن بين فترة أخرى يحدث بينهم وبين سواء بني أمية أو بين العباس يعني قتال أو شيء ثم بعد ذلك بدأوا ينحرفون عقديا شيئا فشيئا.
So the Sheikh said that from the year 64 Hijri, they had this issue with politics, that they disagreed with the leaders of their time, whether those rulers were from Banu Umayyah or from Banu Abbas, the Abbasids or the Umayyads. And this continued for a number of hundred of years, until the 4th century of Islam. The only differences between them and the people of Ahlul Sunnah are the issues that they have with regarding the leaders of the Ummah and politics. It was during the 4th century of Islam that they had a number of the scholars come and begin to change these politics into issues of aqidah and make a different type of difference, and that was one in creed and methodology. And there were a number of scholars during that time, such as Al-Kulayni and Al-Mufid and Al-Suduq and Al-Nu'mani. These were some of their scholars who at that time began to change their political ideology and change it into issues of creed and methodology.
وصاروا يستعيدون بعد ذلك شيئا فشيئا ما كان يقوله عبد الله بن سبأ وأتباعه وهنا قضية هذه الفرقة كما قلت انقسمت إلى فرق كثيرة قريب من 70 فرقة بداية هذا الانقسام في سنة 148 أو 122 من الهجرة هذا بداية الانقسام لمن يدعي محبة أهل البيت أو الولاء لأهل البيت وذلك عندما خرج زيد بن علي بن الحسين بن علي بن أبي طالب خرج على هشام بن عبد الملك وجاءه أناس يريدون أن ينصروه كما قالوا هذا للحسين تعال ننصرك ثم غدروا به جاء أيضا أناس من العراق إلى زيد وقال له نريد أن ننصرك ولكن نريد أن نسألك سؤالا قال سلو قال ما تقول في أبي بكر وعمر ما تقول في أبي بكر وعمر قال هما صاحبا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وأبو بكر جدي قالوا ألا تبرأ منهما قال لا لا أبرأ منهما فلما قال ذلك رضي الله عنه قالوا إذن نرفضك قال اذهبوا فأنتم الرافضة فانقسموا إلى قسمين قسم معه وقسم ضده فالقسم الذين معه استمروا معه قيل لهم الزيدية والقسم الذين انحرفوا عنه قيل لهم الرافضة
The Sheikh said, so during this time from the year 64 onwards, from the 4th century onwards, when they began to change their political ideology into one of Aqidah, this is when they began to take back those opinions of Abdullah ibn Sabah from the time of Uthman radiallahu anhu, and they began to incorporate his ideas and his ideology. The Sheikh said that, as he mentioned before, the Shia, they split into a number of sects, close to 70. The Sheikh said that the beginning of the split within the Shia movement began in the year 122 Hijri. And that was when Zayd ibn Ali, ibn al-Husayn ibn Ali, ibn Abi Talib radiallahu an, one of the descendants of Ali radiallahu an, he wanted to fight and oppose the ruler of that time, Hisham ibn Abd al-Malik. When he made his intention clear, there were a number of people, a group of people who came from Iraq, and they came to support him, just as they wanted to support his grandfathers and his forefathers. But before they supported him, they said that, "We want to ask you a question." And so he asked them what was the question, and they replied, "What is your opinion concerning Abu Bakr and Umar?" And so he replied that, "My opinion concerning them is that both of them are companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And as for Abu Bakr radiallahu an, then he is a grandfather to me. He is one of my forefathers." When they heard this response, they said to him, "Do you not free yourself from them?" And he replied, "No." So when he said this, they said, "Therefore we will reject you. Therefore we will reject you." And that was when the name Rafida was attached to them. So those people who came, they split into two groups. Some of them supported this man, this person, Zayd ibn Ali, and others from amongst them refused to support him and they rejected him. Those who supported him would later become known as the Zaydiyya, and those who rejected and refused to support him, they were known as the Rafida.
وكان أقصى ما يقولونه في ذلك الزمان هو التبرؤ من أبي بكر وعمر، لكن لم يكونوا في ذلك الوقت يقولون بالطواف حول القبور ولا بدعاء غير الله ولا بتحريف القرآن ولا غيرها من العقائد الباطلة التي يقول بها الرافضة اليوم. واستمر الأمر على ذلك حتى جاءت سنة 200 أو قبل سنة 200، سنة 148، عندما توفي جعفر الصادق رضي الله عنه وأرضاه. اختلفوا في من تكون الإمامة بعد جعفر، وذلك كانوا يدعون أن الإمامة في أولاد الحسين. فقال الجماعة في موسى بن جعفر، وقال الجماعة عبد الله بن جعفر، وقال الجماعة محمد بن جعفر، وقال الجماعة إسماعيل بن جعفر، وهم الإسماعيلية، وخرج منهم بعد ذلك العبيديون الفاطميون وغيرهم. فالشاهد من هذا أنهم في سنة 148 صار انقسام كبير بينهم، لكن إلى الآن لم تكن لهم عقائد يظهرونها باطلة. وفي سنة 260، وهو اليوم أو السنة التي مات فيها الحسن العسكري، وذلك أن الشيعة الاثنى عشرية يزعمون أن الإمام في 12 رجل، سأذكر أسماءهم بعد أن ينتهي أخونا.
So the Sheikh said that during that time, so we're up to the early 122, around that time within the Islamic history, during that time all that they would say was that they didn't believe that Abu Bakr and Umar should have been the leaders, that they were against Abu Bakr and Umar and they would free themselves from these two companions. But that was all that they believed. They didn't say anything about the Quran being incorrect. They never used to make tawaf around graves. They never had all of these different types of beliefs that they have today. This continued until the year 184 Hijri. And during that year, that is the year when Ja'far al-Sadiq passed away, one of the descendants of al-Husayn. And they believe that the imams that they have to be from the descendants of al-Husayn radiallahu anhu. So once Ja'far al-Sadiq passed away, they differed as to who should be his successor. And so some of them went for one of his sons by the name of Musa, others went to another one of his sons by the name of Abdullah, a third group went to a different son, a third son by the name of Muhammad, and a fourth group went to a fourth son by the name of Ismail. And from that group, those people that went towards Ismail ibn Ja'far, they were the ones who would later become known as the Ismailiyya, and it was from them that you had the Fatimid dynasty that ruled Egypt for a number of years. So this is during the year 184. Up until this time, they still have no set aqidah, they have no complete belief and ideology. It is just the issue of Abu Bakr and Umar. This continued until the year 260 Hijri, and that is the year when Al-Hasan Al-Askari passed away. And the Shaykh said that the Shia, who are the 12 white Shias, the Ithna Ashariya, they have the belief that the imamah, that their leadership has to be within the 12 imams, and the Shaykh said that he will now expand upon this.
سنة 260 مات الحسن العسكري وليس له ذرية، فظهرت هنا فرقة يقال لها الاثنى عشرية. فلم تظهر فرقة الاثنى عشرية إلا في سنة 260 من الهجرة، وزعموا أن الإمامة في 12 إمام وآخرهم المهدي. فمن هؤلاء الاثنى عشر؟ أولهم، تحفظون معي إن شاء الله؟
Just like you memorize the names of the 12 imams, he's going to go through them.
أولهم علي بن أبي طالب، ثم ابنه الحسن، ثم ابنه الحسين، ثم بعد ذلك في أولاد الحسين، 9 من أولاد الحسين. علي بن الحسين، ثم ابنه محمد المشهور بالباقر، ثم ابنه جعفر المشهور بالصادق، ثم ابنه موسى المشهور بالكاظم، ثم ابنه علي المشهور بالرضا، ثم ابنه الهادي أو علي رضا عفوا، ثم ابنه محمد المشهور بالجواد، ثم ابنه علي المشهور بالهادي، ثم ابنه الحسن المشهور بالعسكري، ثم ابنه المهدي محمد المشهور بالمهدي. هؤلاء 12 إماما يزعمونهم.
So the Sheikh said, we're up to the year 260 Hijri, and that is the year when Al-Hassan Al-Askari passed away. The problem was that he had no children, he had no offspring. And this is now where we begin to have another sect from amongst the Shia, and those are the 12 Shiites, the Ithna Ashariya. They said that the Imama, their leadership, is in 12 Imams. The first of them is Ali radiallahu anhu, and the last of them will be the Mahdi. The 12 Imams are, as the Sheikh has just mentioned, the first of them is Ali, then his son Hassan, then his son Hussein, that's number 3, and then all of the remaining are from the offspring of Hussein. Number 4 is Ali ibn al-Hussein. Number 5 is Muhammad ibn Ali, also known as al-Baqir. Number 6 is Ja'far al-Sadiq. Number 7 is Musa al-Kadhim. Number 8 is Ali al-Rida. Number 9 is Muhammad al-Jawad. Number 10 is Ali al-Hadi. Number 11 is al-Hassan al-Askari. And number 12 will be the Mahdi.
طبعا المهدي هذا مخترع، لأن الحسن لم يكن له الأولاد، وإنما اختلقوا له ولدا لتستمر جريمتهم إلى يوم الدين.
The Sheikh said, and obviously this last Imam, the Mahdi, is something which they invented because Al-Hassan, who is at number 11, Hassan al-Askari, he had no offspring and no children. Rather, this is something which they invented, this Mahdi, for them, so that they can continue to propagate their views until the Day of Judgment.
بعد ذلك تحولت، هنا وقع تحول كبير جدا في هذا المذهب. طبعا إلى الآن لم تكن لهم عقائد يعني يلتزمها الجميع، وإن بعضهم يأخذ من ابن سبأ وبعضهم على أهل السنة وكذا، لكن لم تكن لهم حسينيات، لم يكن لهم ظهور في عقائدهم، وإنما أشياء يبطنها بعضهم أو بعض من ينتسب إلى هذا المذهب من غير المسلمين.
The Sheikh said it was at this point that we have a big change in the madhab and in the beliefs of the Shias. Before this, as we said, there was nothing major. It was all things that they would normally conceal. Some of them took from the beliefs and ideologies of Abdullah ibn Sabah. Others of them would take from some of the beliefs of Ahlul Sunnah. And they had all of these beliefs, but most of them were concealed. And they didn't have a complete ideology or a complete aqidah.
هذا التحول يتمثل في أنهم في بداية الأمر كانوا يكذبون على الناس، يقولون نحن أخذنا هذا الكلام من علي بن أبي طالب، أخذنا هذا الكلام من الحسن، من الحسين، من علي بن الحسين، من الباقر، من الجواد، من الصادق، يكذبون عليهم، وكان الأئمة يتبرؤون منهم ويقولون هؤلاء يكذبون علينا، ليسوا منا، ويعلنون ذلك صراحة. لكن بعد موت الحسن العسكري سنة 260 صاروا ينتسبون إلى إمام معدوم، إلى شخص معدوم لم يخلق أصلاً، لأنه ليس للحسن ولد، فزعموا أن له ولدا وأن هذا الولد مختفي وأنهم هم الوحيدون الذين يتصلون به. فصار الناس بعد ذلك لا يستطيعون أن ينكروا عليهم شيئا، لأن كل ما قال هو قال لنا ولكنه مختفي.
The Sheikh said it was at this point that a great change happened within their beliefs and in their madhab. Before this, what they would do was that they would ascribe lies to people. They would lie upon Ali, upon Hassan, upon Hussein, upon Al-Baqir, upon Ja'far al-Sadiq. They would attribute lies to these people. And those people would free themselves from these lies. So when people would come to them saying that this is what those people say about you, they would say, no, we're free from this, we disagree with this, those people don't follow us, and they're not from amongst us.
لكم أن تتصوروا أن الشيعة في ذلك الوقت كانوا عندما يكذبون على الناس يقول لهم نحن أخذنا هذا الكلام من جعفر الصادق، فالناس يذهبون إلى جعفر الصادق فيسألونه يقول كذب، ما قلت هذا. كانوا يردون على الشيعة يقول نعم قال لكم هذا تقية، هو قال هذا لكن يتقي. فصار بعض الناس يصدقونهم وبعض الناس يكذبونهم، واستمروا على ذلك مع هؤلاء الأئمة. لكن المصيبة بعد موت الحسن العسكري صاروا يحيلون إلى معدوم. يعني في السابق كانوا يقولون قال لنا جعفر، الناس تذهب إلى جعفر، قال لنا موسى، الناس تذهب إلى موسى. هؤلاء يعني الكذابين منهم، هؤلاء كانوا يزعمون أنهم يتصلون بهؤلاء الأئمة والأئمة يبرؤون منهم. فبعد ذلك صاروا يحيلون إلى معدوم، قال لنا محمد ابن الحسن. طيب أين محمد ابن الحسن؟ هذا لم يره أحد، لم يرى أحد محمد ابن الحسن هذا، لأنه أصلا لم يولد، وإنما هو وجد بالخيال، فصاروا ينسبون إليه. وخرج عند ذلك أناس زعموا أنهم يلتقون به، وهم من يسمونهم بالأبواب أو السفراء، وهم أربعة، واستمروا يكذبون على الناس 70 سنة في أنهم يلتقون به ويجلسون معه ويأخذون أسئلتهم ويأتونهم بالإجابات، وعندما يسألون أين هو يقول لا أحد يعلم، لا نريد أن نخبر أحدا.
The Sheikh said, so you can imagine at this point of time that what used to happen before was that they would ascribe something, for example, to Ja'far al-Sadiq or one of the imams, and so the people would go directly to that person and say, did you say this? And they would say, no, we free ourselves from what they say. What they're saying is a complete lie. And then they would go back to these people who ascribed those lies, and some of them would say, no, that this is a type of taqiyah, this is a type of hiding and a type of twisting the truth or lying. And so he didn't really want to tell you the truth. And so some people would believe them, some people would disagree, and they would refuse to believe them. The problem that took place and the calamity that struck was that after the death of Al-Hasan Al-Askari, they invented a figment of the imagination. This son of his, Al-Mahdi, wasn't born, doesn't exist, but they claimed that he was there and that only they had access to him. And so they would take the questions of people and they would take their issues and they would go back and they would come back with answers. And when people would say, we want to meet him, they would say, no, no one is allowed to go except us. These people were known as Al-Abwab or As-Sufara. There were four of these individuals during that time who for 70 years continued to do this. They would just go and claim that they were the only people that had access to this imam, and they would then bring back answers and bring back issues that they would make up themselves.
واستمر هؤلاء الأربعة وهم عثمان العمري ثم ابنه محمد ثم الحسين بن روح النبختي ثم علي السمري، استمروا 70 سنة يعني واحد ثم الآخر ثم الآخر يكذبون على الناس. وفي سنة 330 لما توفي السمري قال قبل أن يموت انتهت علاقتنا بالمهدي، الآن غاب الغيب الكبرى، الآن لا أحد يتصل به بعد اليوم.
The Sheikh said that these four people, one after the other, they would claim that they had access to this Mahdi. So the first of them was Uthman al-Amri, then his son Muhammad, then a man by the name of al-Husayn ibn al-Ruh, and then finally Ali al-Samri. For 70 years, one after the other, so when one would pass away, it would pass to the other one. For 70 years, they claimed that they had access to this Imam. In the year 330 Hijri, at the time of the death of the fourth one, Ali al-Samri, he said, now our connection to this Imam has finished. We've been cut off from him. And he said, now the great unseen has occurred, meaning that we no longer have access to this Imam.
هذا هو التحول الخطير الذي وقع. فبعد أن كانوا ينسبون بعض الأمور إلى جعفر الصادق والباقر وعلي بن الحسين إلى أناس أحياء، صاروا يحيلون إلى معدوم. عندها خرج جماعة كبيرة جدا من الشيعة، كل يدعي أنه له صلة بالمهدي خاصة، وصاروا يكذبون على الناس ويؤلفون لهم دينا آخر. فألف دين جديد، وخرج جماعة من العلماء كالكليني والنعماني والمفيد والصدوق والطوسي والمرتضى وغيرهم من علماء تلك الفترة، وصار الشيعة الآن لهم عقائد خاصة، وصاروا يقولون بتحريف القرآن، وصاروا يقولون بتكفير أصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، وبردة المسلمين بشكل عام، وبكفر كل من لم يكن 22، وبالطواف حول القبور ودعاء غير الله، وإن الأئمة يعلمون الغيب ويتصرفون في الكون. وبدأت تلك العقائد الباطلة تخرج شيئا فشيئا، وقامت لهم بعد ذلك بعض الدول، أقولها سريعة بعد أن يذكروا ما ذكرته الآن.
So the Sheikh said that this is when you had the dangerous stage in the development of the Shia as a sect. And that is before they used to just ascribe their things to living people, and so those people would be able to reject what they say. For after the death of the 11th Imam, they began to ascribe things to a person who doesn't even exist, isn't even dead, he's just a figment of their imagination. This is when you had now many groups, different people coming out, each one claiming that he has the connection to this Imam that is hidden. And that's where you had people lying, and you had people beginning to now put together a new type of religion with a new type of belief and aqidah. And this is the time, as the Sheikh mentioned before, that you had many of their scholars, the likes of Al-Kulayni and Al-Nu'mani and Al-Mufid and Al-Tusi and Al-Murtada and others, they came out, and step by step they began to give them a whole new aqidah, a whole new belief and ideology. So this is when they began to say, for example, the role of the companions, or the vast majority of them, are disbelievers. This is when they began to say that the Quran is incomplete or that it's been changed. This is when they began to allow their people to go and make tawaf around the graves of the imams, and they began to say that the imams, you can make dua to them, and the imams know the unseen, and that they can change the universe, and so on. This is when this began to take place, and based upon this, following on from this, they also had a number of dynasties as well.
قلت قامت لهم بعض الدول باختصار، الدولة البويهية، وذلك في القرن الرابع الهجري سنة 334، واستمرت قريب من 115 سنة، سقطت سنة 447 على يد السلاجقة، وقام القرامطة كذلك، وكان منهم حمدان قرمط وأبو علي الجنابي الذي أخذ الحجر الأسود وأخذ كسوة الكعبة ودفن زمزم بالمسلمين بعد قتلهم، وذكر أنه قتل عند الكعبة أكثر من 30,000 نفس. والدولة البويهية لما قامت ذكروا أنهم يعني أفسدوا في الأرض فسادا عظيما، ولكن دولتهم لم تستمر أكثر من 115 سنة، وقامت في خلالها الدولة العبيدية الذين سموا أنفسهم بالفاطميين. بدأت باليمن، ثم انتقلت إلى المغرب، ثم إلى مصر، واستمرت هذه الدولة 260 سنة، من سنة 296 إلى سنة 564، حيث سقطت هذه الدولة على يد صلاح الدين الأيوبي رحمه الله تعالى. وقامت كذلك بعد ذلك الدولة الصفوية سنة 906 من الهجرة، وقبلها كانت إيران دولة سنية 100%، ولكن في هذا القرن، في القرن العاشر الهجري سنة 906، قام الصفويون في إيران احتلوها، وقامت دولتهم واستمرت إلى 1146، يعني أيضا قريب من 150 سنة أو 140 سنة تقريبا، هذه الدولة الصفوية.
So the Sheikh said that they had a number of dynasties. From them is the dynasty of the Buwayhiyya, which was in the 4th century of Islam from the year 334 until the year 447. So it lasted for approximately 150 years. And it is said in the books of history that when they took over, this dynasty caused a lot of evil and corruption upon the earth. Then you had another dynasty by the name of Al-Qaramita, and they had people like Hamdan Qarmut and Abu Ali. And this person, Abu Ali, was the one who he stole the black stone from the Kaaba, and he took the kiswa, the covering of the black stone, and he killed approximately 30,000 people. And in Mecca near the Haram, he buried people within the well of Zamzam. Another one of their dynasties was the Ubaidiyya dynasty, also known as the Fatimid dynasty, which began in Yemen, then spread to Morocco, and eventually settled in Egypt. And that began in the year 260 of the Hijrah, and it finished in the year 564 of the Hijrah, when Salah ad-Din al-Ayyubi, he toppled over their dynasty. Another one of their dynasties was the Safawiyya, which began in the year 906 of the Hijrah. And before this, the Sheikh said Iran was a complete country of the Sunnis. So the Sunni Ahlul Sunnah were in Iran until this year 906 of the Hijrah, when they had this dynasty of the Safawiyya, and they continued within Iran until the year 1146 of the Hijrah.
والملاحظ في دولهم أنها قصيرة أعمارها لكنها كثيرة شرورها. كثيرة شرورها. القرامطة عندما خرجوا وقام هذا الخبيث الجنابي وقتل الحجاج عند الكعبة وكان يقول أنا بالله وبالله أنا يخلق الخلق وأفنيهم أنا، وقتل عددا كبيرا من الناس ودفن ماء بئر زمزم بالمسلمين، وأخذ كما قلنا الحجر الأسود وجلس في البحرين اللي هي الإحساء قريبا من 20 سنة. وكان الخرقي هو أحد مؤلفين في مذهب أحمد رحمه الله تعالى، في زمنه كان الحجر الأسود غير موجود لما ألف رسالته في الفقه، فقال وإذا طفت الكعبة تأتي الحجر الأسود وتقبله إن وجدته، يقول إنه لم يكن موجودا في ذلك الوقت. وكذلك الدولة العبيدية أفسدت في المغرب وفي مصر وفي اليمن، ثم كذلك أنا أقصد المغرب العربي بشكل عام في تونس والمغرب والجزائر، ثم بعد ذلك الدولة هم طبعا شاركوا في سقوط الدولة العباسية على يد النصير الطوسي ومعه ابن العلقمي مع هولاكو، وسقطت الدولة العباسية سنة 656 على أيديهم، وقتل أكثر من 1.5 مليون مسلم في بغداد وحدها. وبعد ذلك جاءت الدولة الصفوية وقتل في إيران أكثر من 1 مليون مسلم. واليوم تقوم دولتهم الآن في إيران بعد سقوط الشاه، تقوم دولته، والشاه شيعي طبعا لكن دولة علمانية كانت، لكن كدولة دينية الآن تقوم دولتهم الدينية، وأنتم تعلمون كم خرج أو ظهر على أيديها من الفساد، والله المستعان.
The Sheikh said one of the things to notice and take note of about these dynasties was that even though their time spans may be short, there was a lot of evil that they would commit within their rule. And so for example you have the Qaramita, and you have this person Abu Ali who went and he killed and he slaughtered and massacred thousands of the pilgrims, and he would say that I am Allah and Allah is me, he is the one who creates and I am the one who kills. And so he would then go and he took the black stone away and he went to Bahrain and lived there for 20 years, and he took the black stone and the covering of the Kaaba. And that's why the Sheikh mentioned that Imam Al-Khiraqi, who's one of the students of Imam Ahmad rahimahullah from his madhab, he writes in his book of fiqh that if you go around the Kaaba and you're making tawaf, you kiss the black stone if you can find it. Because it was during that time that the black stone was removed, and so that's why he wrote this, that if you find it, you kiss it, otherwise you don't. The point being that there was a lot of evil that came as a result of them. And then you had the Ubaidi Fatimid dynasty that went from Yemen to Morocco. And what we mean by Morocco is the old type of Morocco, which was Western Africa and Southern Europe. And then they went to Egypt as well. And these were the people who helped bring about the demise of the Abbasid dynasty, which was toppled in the year 656 Hijri. And it is said that during that time in Baghdad alone, over 1.5 million Muslims were massacred. And then you have another one of the dynasties, the Safawiyya, when they all took over in Iran, they killed and massacred 1 million Muslims. And the Sheikh said, even today in the modern day Iran, you still have many problems resulting and emanating from them, as everyone knows.
يعني هذه إطلالة سريعة على نشأة هذه الفرقة المنحرفة وهي كما قلت مقتضبة ومعتصرة ولا شك أن الأمر كان يحتاج أكثر من هذا لكن الحمد لله على كل حال.
So the Sheikh said that this was a very quick, brief summary, and the Sheikh said in reality, you know, we should have given it a lot more importance, a lot more, gone into a lot more depth, but time doesn't allow. And all praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So inshallah we're going to conclude with this lecture. It's time for Asr now. And after Asr, inshallah, we'll have the next lecture immediately, which will be the differences between Ahlul Sunnah and the Shia, and that will be delivered by Sheikh Fahad Al-Muqrin. So inshallah we're going to pray Asr, and then straight after Asr, inshallah, we'll begin with the next lecture. Jazakumullah khair.